And if you would please stand, we will continue on with our call to worship, number 334, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine, 334.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine! Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers above. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
And you may be seated.
Well, good morning, Hillcrest Baptist Church. A little rain in the forecast, but we needed it, and it's good to be here this morning to worship our one and only God with you all this morning. I have a few announcements for you. Lots of activities going on as the school year ends and the summer begins. We've got a lot of things going on. First thing, the joys. And in case you didn't know what a joy was, a joy is just older youth serving. My father-in-law, who was a pastor for many years, led the seniors down in Lebanon, First Baptist Lebanon. And I asked him last week, I said, what constitutes a joy, or triple L is what they call. I said, what age group? And he said, I better not stand up before you and ask that question. It might be dangerous. And so the definition of a joy is just somebody who is older youth and still serving. And so you are welcome to come to the barbecue. Or the cookout on May 26th. That's this Thursday at 11 a.m. The youth, you got a lot of activities going on. First of all, tonight we are going to be doing Sunday Night Live at the Gillilands. And Don is excited about a game that he found for us. If you are interested in hosting the youth some Sunday night, just get with me or Hannah and let us know. And we would love to come out and spend some time with you all. We also have on June 6th, the youth will be traveling to Union University for our mission trip at Union University. So be praying for us as we gear up to go there and cross all of our I's and dot all of our T's and get everything ready, I guess. Special music night is coming up on May 29th at 6 p.m. Sign up out in the foyer if you're willing to share the gift that God has given you. And, of course, on the back of your bulletin is VBS. VBS is coming up quickly. Teachers are busy getting their lessons planned and their rooms organized and decorated. And so we're excited about that, be inviting people in the community, be inviting cousins and nieces and nephews. We want to pack this place for VBS. I want to welcome our visitors this morning and tell you we're glad that you have chosen this morning to come worship God in Hillcrest Baptist Church this morning. We want to welcome you, and the way we're going to do that is we're going to stand up, we're going to shake your hand and sing.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joy dares with Jesus as we travel this art. For I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joy dares with Jesus as we travel this art. For I'm part of the family of God.
All right, you can be seated. We got a lot going on this morning, and I am so grateful that we have people here to do things. It's always busy at Hillcrest Baptist Church, and we appreciate God for allowing you to be part of it. We're going to pray. As we pray, I want you to think about people that are not here. Some are sick. Some are busy. Some are working. And some, the truth of the matter is, don't want to be here. So let's pray for each other. If you know somebody that doesn't want to be here, then pray for them and ask God to bring them back. So let's pray together. Father, Lord, we sure love you and praise you. We're here today to worship Almighty God. And Father, we're not ashamed to call you Father. We're not ashamed to call you Creator. You are our God. You're our Messiah, our Savior, our way to heaven. And we praise you, Father. We worship the name of Jesus this morning. And Father, you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we just praise you for that. And God, we thank you for the blessings that you pour out on this church, for the people of this church. And God, you have been so good to us. And the new building is coming along, and Father, you bless that so many different ways. And then the mission part of the activities, Father, we continue to reach out to the neighborhood and all parts of the world, and that's because you've allowed us to, and we thank you, God, for that. We pray for our loved ones that are sick, Lord, and some are in nursing homes, and some are waiting for tests, and some are experiencing surgeries, and God, we lift them up to you and ask that you just touch them in a great and mighty way, and they just feel the presence of God in their life. We do pray, Father, for those that would like to be here, but they can't. Lift them up to you, Father, and ask there be a time that you could allow them to come. And I pray for those that do not want to be here. And Father, a lot of the neighborhood, whether they're members of this church or other churches, have just not, they don't want to be in church anymore. And I pray for them. Lord, I pray that we would be a church that would be a lighthouse to them and attract them. And Father, that if there's any way we could minister to them, I pray, God, that you give us the opportunities. Father, as we worship and song and praying and reading the Bible and hearing the Word of God preach, I pray, Lord, that everything that is said and done would bring honor and glory to your name. We're here today, Father, for you, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, children, come on up. All right, sit down. You guys are going to help me, okay? Will you help me?
Yes.
Will you do what I ask you to do? Will you be good?
Yes.
No talking?
Yes.
No cutting up? No standing in the corner? What I'm going to do in a minute is I'm going to ask all of you to sit in the pews with me. And there may not be room, so there's a couple seats right back there. Carol, scoot over that way maybe if we need you to. You're going to help me do this. Now, here's what I want you to do. All right, stand up. Do this. My mistake. Yes, it was. You're a preacher, so wimp. Okay, can you do that when I tell you to? Okay, now this is going to be y'all's time. And then when you sit down, I want you to look up here. Were you just peeking? Yes, you were. Okay. We're going to have all our graduates come on forward. Sarah, Steve, we'll recognize you in a second. We've got two others. I think they're not here. Hannah Milburn and Jaden Mays. But you guys come on over here. We love our graduates. Sarah, I've known you just about all your life. Landon, I visited you when you were a baby. Do you remember that? I'm surprised because you've been smart all these years. That's yours. There'll be homework about this. These are devotionals, and I believe in devotionals. Use them every day, and it helps you get through the day. And we're very proud of you. It took you 12 years to get through. You know how long it took me? 18 years to get through 12. I made it look really good, easy. No, I got through 12. So here's the deal. Let's give them a hand. Now, shake their hands. Shake the hands. Now, that's not how I was told you to do it. There you go. Shake their hands. Everybody shake their hands. They're going to remember this, and you guys are too, because when you guys graduate, then we're going to shake your hand too. All right, you guys sit down now the best you can. And Richard is going to come and pray a prayer for Sarah, and then Steve Hibbers will pray a prayer for Landon. So, oh boy, oh boy, Sarah's in trouble.
She's been in my class now for 4 years, and I don't know how she got so aggravating tall. It's either that or I'm getting shorter to the ground. I think gravity's taking over. I just want to pray for you. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for Sarah Grace, and Father, I just have enjoyed these years with her, and I know, Lord, that she would go do great things, going to Austin Peay and going to do her studies there. And Father, I know that she'll be faced with several different challenges, but Lord, I know that her favorite verse is Philippians 4:13. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Father, and I claim that verse today for her. And I pray these things in Jesus' name.
I won't make you hold my hand. I am going to wrap my arm around you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this young man and his life. I just lift him up to you now, Father God, as he closes one chapter of his life through high school and enters into another one, Father God. I just know that you have great things in store for him. And I know, Lord, that he is knowledgeable about the Bible and about your word. But more importantly, Lord, I know that he's got a personal relationship with you. And I know, Lord, that whatever he chooses to do, it will be in obedience to you and that you will bless him for it. Father God, guide him and direct him in his ways. We love you and we praise you. In Christ's name, amen.
Let's give them all a hand. All right, stand up, turn around, and you remember this part. Steve Collins, you stand up. Do the same for Steve. Steve graduated from college. He is going to be, what are you going to do? Man, Susan says, it's about time. Anyways, he's been going to school and working and doing it the hard way. He's not a young man anymore. He's pretty old. And so we love you, brother. I'm proud of you. Okay, kids, y'all sit down now in the pews so you can see. Scoot over. Scoot that way. There you go. Come on. Sit in the pews and then look up here. Come on.
trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
When Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight, you picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is, everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history.
Going down in history.
As another blood-bought, faithful member of the family.
That's all I ever want to be.
And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
'Cause I'm just a nobody,
nobody.
Trying to tell all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Do you know who did those puppets?
Yeah, Landon.
Landon.
Hannah.
Elise. Hannah. And Savannah. Do you know how old they were when they first started the puppets? About your age. About your age. They started watching and wanting to do puppets. So I wanted them to do that in front of you guys so that you could start thinking, well, I could do that. And you could grow up in our church and do the puppets like that. You guys were really good. I like it when you're good.
And you may remain seated as we continue on with number 2, Holy, 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 number 2. Stand as we sing number 4, To God Be the Glory, number 4.
Praise the Lord, let the earth hear.
can see them.
Well, I just wanted to begin by saying that this song is a ballad. It's a story that I'm telling, a testimony of something that occurred to me in my Christian life a few weeks ago. And it's also been inspired by Psalm 40, which our pastor was gracious enough to preach about, and it just happened to go in a line with what had happened to me. So, with all that, I want to just quote three verses. These verses aren't in my song, but they're important to me. It says, I delight to do thy will, O my God. This is in Proverbs 40, 8, 9, and 10. I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips, O Lord, thou knowest. I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared thy faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy loving kindness and thy truth from the great congregation. And the reason I chose those verses is because I believe that's the kind of preacher we have. Amen? And I believe that the Holy Spirit is working through him and working through us in this church. I have known that. I haven't been coming here very long, but I have known that from the first day I ever visited here. So, without any further ado, here's Pray, Trust, and Wait. Get my pick here. I had just got to work. I felt good in my soul. I was thankful to the Lord for the day. It's so hard to live for Christ in a world full of sin, for Satan attacks in every way. I took offense in a serious way. I got angry and used some words Christians shouldn't use. I couldn't understand how I could feel so abused. I said a prayer to Jesus to forgive me, asked him to show me a sign. Waiting at a stoplight in the car next to mine, lady hung a message with these simple three lines. Oh, pray, trust, and wait. The Holy Spirit told me, pray, pray without ceasing to your Lord. It's what you must do. Trust, trust in the Lord your God, that he'll listen to you. And wait, wait on his answer to your prayer. It's so hard to do. Pray, trust, and wait. He'll have an answer for you.
Sunday I went to church. All these things had slipped from my mind. But when the pastor started preaching, I had quite a surprise, an encounter of a spiritual kind. It began, I waited patiently upon the Lord. He inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me from a pit full of miry clay, set my feet upon a rock where it was dry. He put a new song in my mouth, giving praise to Him. Many shall see it and fear and trust my God. Blessed is the man who trusts the Lord our God. Oh, pray, trust, and obey. Psalm 40 tells us pray. Tell the Lord just what you need. Praise Him as you do. And trust, know that the Lord your God, He will listen to you. And have an answer for you. Pray, trust, and wait. He'll have an answer for you. You've got to pray, trust, and
sometimes it's tough to get up here and preach after something like we've experienced. David wrote that in 2 weeks, I think, maybe three. And then Landon, since it's only a brand new song, hadn't had time to practice very good. So didn't they both do really good? Yeah. And I forgot to mention that Hayden was behind the curtain too. Curtain number five. All right, if you would, turn your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 29. Jeremiah 29. I'm going to read 1 through 14, but there's only a couple verses that I really want us to zero in on. But if you would, Jeremiah 29. Verses 1 through 14. As I read this, I want you to think about 2,600 years ago, as Jeremiah got his words from the Lord. And I want you to think about today, what we go through, what we're going through right now, too. Now, these are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem to the remainder of the elders who were carried away captive, to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had carried away captive from Jerusalem to Babylon. This happened after Jeconiah, the king, the queen, the mother, the eunuchs, the princesses, Judah, and Jerusalem, the craftsmen and the smiths had departed from Jerusalem. The letter was sent by the hand of Elisha, the son of Shaphan, and Gemariah, the son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to Babylon, to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, saying, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who were carried away captive, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands so that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there, not diminished. And seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it, for in its peace you will have peace. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams, which you cause to be dreamed. For they prophesy falsely to you in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. For thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you and cause you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, says the Lord, and will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations, from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you to the place for which I caused you to be carried away captive. This message is a message for our students who graduated as they go into the next chapter of their life. I want them to hear that God has a purpose for their life, but it's not just for our graduates. It's for Hillcrest Baptist Church. And I want us to hear that God has a plan for us as well, for the Family Life Center, for the missions that He gives us to do. He's got a plan for this church, but it's not just for the graduates and Hillcrest Baptist Church. It's for you, the individuals that are here today. As we think about our future, this is just a sojourn in this world. So I'm going to share with you the definition of sojourn. It means a temporary stay when used as a noun. As a verb, it means to stay somewhere temporarily. Either way, we are staying in a place that is not ours, and it's for a short time compared to eternity. All this to say, God has a plan for every Christian, and it's not temporary, and it's not a temporary stay. It's for eternity in heaven with Him. That ought to deserve some amens. I don't know about you, but I like the thought that my future home is permanent, and there's never a time when I'm not going to be there. Eternity is forever. You can't hardly describe it. You can't hardly put your mind around it, but believe me, we want it. We want to spend eternity with Jesus. Jesus, now I want you to see this. See my hands. Jesus holds our future in His hands. The title of this message is God Holds the Future. He holds the future for all of us. So I want to give you some background leading up to verses 11 through 14. God's people are living in exile right now. They've been departed from Jerusalem to Babylon. They lost their land, they've lost their homes, some of them lost their families, they've lost their riches. They lost everything they had except what they could carry on their back as they were deported from Jerusalem. They had been carried away because they had been living in rebellion and rejecting God's word for so many years. And God tells them over and over, there's going to be dire consequences, and now the consequences have taken place. The Bible tells us that God calls them to be deported. And they don't miss this point. God calls them to be deported because of the sin in their life. Many had been separated from their families. They bought into idolatry. They bought into false teaching. And while they were in captivity, Jeremiah told them this. Now, this is why I want you to think about then and now think about today too. Settle down and live life and take care of your business. It'll be for a short time, which is 70 years. I want you to build houses. I want you to marry. I want to give your kids in marriage. I want you to plant gardens. I want you to carry on about life. After 70 years, God says, I will visit you again. And I don't know what his thinking was, but my thinking would have been, if I'd been God, I'll visit you in 70 years and see if you're doing what I told you to do. And I have a feeling that's what God was going to do too. We in the United States might not be living in exile, but today there's a lot of people suffering in our country. Some cannot make ends meet financially. Some have lost their homes. Have you tried the real estate market lately to rent a place? You can't even afford to rent a one-bedroom apartment. Somebody was telling me this morning that the new apartments over the 101st and 41A, a one-bedroom is $1,400 a month. A two-bedroom is $1,500 a month, I think she told me, and a three-bedroom is like $1,900 a month. Now, who can afford that? That's the state we're in. Jobs, we're told, are available, and you go apply for one, and many are being told you're not qualified to do these jobs. I think some of them are postages because everybody else is posting help wanted, but that's just me. Inflation, have you noticed things cost a little bit more, a whole lot more? Have you filled up your tank lately? I know we have. If you got a baby, you can't buy baby food or formula for that child. Yet hear this. God still has us in the palm of his hands. God is still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God is in control, and God has our future. You, the students, and Hillcrest Baptist Church, he has our future in his hands. We're going to make it. We belong to God. And Jeremiah is giving us things from God to tell us how to get through the judgment, the exile, the deportation, the yuck of life. So that's what we're going to look at today, the instruction while we wait on God to fix all this mess. And one day he's going to. So let's start out. The first thing Jeremiah teaches us to make a, this is kind of odd, he's telling us, make the best of things right now. Now you don't hear that very often. You hear, I want, or give me, or you can do better, you can do this, but God is telling us, make the best of the situation right now. Look at verses 4 through 6. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who were carried away, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem. Did you notice? I have caused, God caused them. I want you to build houses. I want you to dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons, give your daughters to husbands so that they may bear sons and daughters. You notice generation taking place. So they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there, not diminished, and seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it, for in its peace you will have peace, for thus saith the Lord of hosts. So he's telling us, students especially, who are going out in the job market right now, and if you're looking for a job and can't find one, or if you can't pay your electric bill, don't get too discouraged. That's a huge statement there. It's so easy to get discouraged today. In Jeremiah's day, God caused his people to be deported from their own homes. Now, aren't we fortunate that God hasn't moved us out of the United States and sent us somewhere? Can you think of another place in this world that you'd rather live than the United States? If God did it once, he could do it twice. So I don't know about you, but I feel like praising God. Thank you that I'm still here in the United States. It may be tough to put gas in the car, but I'm still a child of God in the free country we have. God calls those people to be deported because of sin in their life. I don't know if some of the stuff we're going through is judgment or not. That's up to God. But it could be. And if it is, who could blame God for the way we are in the United States today? We are sinful. We make laws that reject God's word completely, and then we follow those laws. But through it all, we still have the promise from God. And here's what he says to all of us: I will never leave you nor forsake you. What a promise. Doesn't matter what we're going through, I'll never leave you because you belong to me. So whatever happens and wherever you're at and whatever the future holds, a child of God ought to be able to make the best of circumstances, because these circumstances are temporary at best. The time is short, and to make the best of every situation, the key is to abide in Christ, to live like Christ, to love like Christ, to look around and do the things of Christ, to plan your life around Christ, that He is the center of your life. And as He's the center of your life and you remember whose hands you're in, you can make the best of things. Jeremiah teaches us another vital lesson in verse 7. Read it with me. And seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away. And then what's the next thing? And pray to the Lord. So pray wherever you're at. Pray whatever circumstances you're going through. Ask God to bless you in whatever you're facing. Jesus knows and always will know what you're going through. He is truly the King of Kings, the Creator of all of us. He created this soul, your soul. He created your body. He created the oxygen that you live, breathe in. He knows, so He's telling us wherever you're at, pray. And I'm not talking about just, Lord, bless me. If you need a job, pray for it. If you need to further your education, pray for it. If you need healing, pray for it. If you need a house, pray for it. If you need direction in your life, pray for it. If you need, and this is a biggie for Christians, if you need to know the purpose that God has for your life, ask Him. Pray for it. Talked about false teachings. Back then, they had a lot of false teachers telling them things, and they bought into it. Well, we have false teachers today. But the false teaching has been taking place a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit here, a little bit there, over a long period of time. There was one show that I think a lot of us liked, started in 1955 and ended up in 1975, 20 years. Anybody know which show it is? Gunsmoke. I was watching Gunsmoke yesterday, and I wrote down things that I learned from Gunsmoke. Now, we're laughing, but this is what happened to our country. We've bought into it's okay to everybody gather in a saloon. Matt Dillon, we love him, don't we? But come on, Chester, sit down and let's have a beer together and discuss the situation. In 1955, through 1975, we're saying it's okay to meet in a saloon and discuss our problems. That's just one thing that I learned from Matt Dillon. But then the episode yesterday, there was two guys that were drunk. They were drunk as could be. And here goes a chair. And here goes a neck when the chair hit him. And then they threw a beer bottle and hit the mirror and broke the mirror. For 20 years, we learned that it's okay to go to a saloon and talk over the problems and then get drunk and fight. We're laughing, but that's exactly what happens when we watch TV. We just get indoctrinated to this. And I don't know why God put this on my heart, but I thought I'd share it with you. Because you're all guilty. We bought into it. And then they get wrestling, and one throws them through a window, and then the other jumps out of the window of the saloon, and they jump on each other, and they're hitting each other, and neither one of them's got a gun, and somebody hands the other one a gun. And he's going to kill the guy. The gun had a hair trigger and missed the guy that he was going to kill and hit the guy that was instigating all of this between them. Well, we continue to watch that kind of garbage on TV. And over a period of time, you tell me that's not false teaching. Because we just get so used to it, and it becomes part of life. And oh man, we love gun smoke. Well, I'm going to get phone calls. I know I am. So if I see you blinking on my, I'm not answering until a week from now. Just get over it. We watch Gunsmoke. We record Gunsmoke. Rhonda does. She likes it a lot. You know, I would never do that. But I'll get another phone call from her when I get home. We laugh, but it is truthful. We have bought into all this garbage, and there is false teaching back then and today as well, and it continues. Can you remember the first time that, I'll not share this, but I remember the first time that somebody kissed somebody else on TV, and it wasn't a man and a woman. Oh, me, that was terrible, but now you see it every single night just about. Remember I Love Lucy? They didn't even sleep in the same bed, and they were married. They had twin beds. Dick Van Dyke, same way. They weren't even allowed to say the word pregnant. But we do now, don't we? We say anything and everything on TV. We bought into it. Make sure you listen to God and not the false teaching that's taking place as a Christian. And then focus on the long term, not the short term. Look at verse 10. For thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed in Babylon, I will visit you. 70 years is a long time, isn't it? Focus on the long term after 70 years. God says, make the best while you're here, whatever the situation is. When I'm coming after 70 years, doesn't the Bible say something about Jesus coming back now? He's going to come get us one day. He doesn't say it's 70 years. He doesn't say it's 2 weeks. He says, I'm coming back. And we live as if he's coming back this very day. Pray we don't have to spend 70 years in the sinfulness that we're experiencing in the United States of America. Keep on going in verse 11. It reads, listen to God. Verse 11, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. What a verse. I've got you in my hands. You belong to me. Pray to me. And then listen to what I have to say. I know the plans I have for you. I know the plans I have for the graduates. I know the plans I have for each one of us. And those plans include peace and hope and blessings of his presence. It's such a privilege to know that God's right here. David, your song was right on the money. The presence of God, the holiness of God is at Hillcrest Baptist Church. That's not by accident, by the way. It's because we practice worshiping God. We're not ashamed of God. We preach his word. We teach his word. We try our best to be part of the activities. We commit our lives to him. We surrender our lives to him. The key is to turn from evil and wickedness and walk in God's ways. If you're going to walk in God's ways, then you need to learn God's ways. That comes right there. He knows the thoughts. He knows whether you're walking in his ways or not. He knows what you're thinking and how you're thinking. He knows what you're going to react to today. He will deliver you from whatever you're going through because he has you in the palm of his hands. So one way or another, he's going to accomplish his purpose in our lives. And then Jeremiah teaches us to seek the Lord in all things. Look at verses 12 through 14. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me. When you search for me with all your heart, I will be found by you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you to the place for which I caused you to be carried away captive. The Bible tells us in these verses to call upon God, and this is a personal message to each one of us. Call upon God. Pray to me, and here's a promise. I'll listen to you. That's a pretty good promise. I can't tell you how many times people say, I pray and I don't hear God. Well, he hears you. He's just got a timing, and sometimes his timing's not our timing. But it's a personal promise to us. You pray and I'll listen. Seek me and find me, and do it with all your heart, and I promise you God knows whether you're seeking him with all your heart or not. He will be found. The Bible says, this is God, not me. We will be found, and he will deliver us. We are to take a stand on the Word of God. Do you agree with that? Our people, God's people. I want you to run over to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 22. I want you to look at verse 5 with me. We are to take a stand with God. A woman shall not wear anything that pertains to a man, nor shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all who do so are an abomination to the Lord. What that verse just tell us? A man ought to wear man's clothes. A woman ought to wear women's clothes. There's no cross-dressing. If there's cross-dressing, what's that verse say? We're an abomination to the Lord. I bring this up because we're going to open up the Family Life Center and we're going to have guidelines. And one of those guidelines, I don't know how we're going to word it, we're going to get a lawyer to help us, but one of those guidelines is saying men will use the men's bathroom and the women will use the women's bathroom. There'll be no sharing. I hope we all agree with that because that's scripture and that's what happens. If I had a young girl and she was over there and a man wanted to go and use the bathroom with her, you'd see your preacher take off his cloth and turn back to his old ways. That's just not, it can't not happen. We're standing for God. Look at Leviticus, Leviticus 18, verse 22. Leviticus 18, 22. I know this one hurts, but this is the Word of God. You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It's an abomination. Man and man do not lie together. Woman and woman do not lie together. Homosexuality is wrong. It's an abomination to the Lord. Some of us have loved ones that are homosexual. I do. Some of you do. I love my brother, but he's a homosexual. I've preached to him and preached to him till I don't preach to him anymore. He knows the difference. In fact, he used to preach. That hurts because he's an abomination to the Lord because he continues to practice that stuff. And so be it. I know what the Word of God says, and I'm going to take a stand, and this church is going to take a stand on God's Word. He knows his thoughts for us and his purpose for us, and his purpose is that we preach the Word of God and nothing else. We stand on the Word of God and nothing else. I want you to look at Jeremiah chapter 1. This is pretty personal too. Verses 4 and 5. Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Before Jeremiah was ever formed in the womb, the Bible says God knew him. Before you were born, Jeremiah, I sanctified you. I ordained you. This was all before he was ever even conceived. Now, what would happen had his mama had an abortion? We wouldn't have Jeremiah, would we? So we take a stance against abortion issues. I had to pray and pray and pray about these three things before I get up here to present them to you. But this is God's word. We believe that God has life. And I believe that God had my life before he created this world. I believe he knew when he was going to let me be created by mom and dad. I'm very grateful that my mother didn't abort me. What would have happened today, right this very moment, if mom would have aborted me? Simple. You'd have a different preacher here. It wouldn't be me. Some of you are probably saying, maybe. We're not ashamed of the gospel. Romans 1:16. We are not ashamed of God's word. We take a stand on God's word, no matter what. It may hurt. There may be laws that we'll fight against. We may be sued. But God has the plans for this church. He has the plans for each one of us. And those of us that are obedient to God, we're going to follow God's word and nothing else. We're not going to listen to false teachers. We're not going to listen to politicians that tell us what we have to do or not if it's against God's word. We need to speak straight. And I read this yesterday in one of my devotions. It's called Devotion for Men by Stuart Briscoe. This is the devotion that our deacons are reading with me. It goes like this. During a close re-election campaign, a southern senator visited a small town in the backwoods of his state. The issue demanding most attention in the lackluster election was squirrel hunting. The people were deeply divided over the issue. Some believed that they had the right to hunt the little animals. Others thought the practice was barbaric and should be banned. So the senator was asked to state his position on the issue. He's a politician. He's in front of the people that elected him. Now he's got to state he's either for it or against it. After careful thought and probably after checking the polls, the senator replied, "Some of my friends are squirrel hunters, and some of my friends think squirrel hunting should be banned. If you look carefully at my record, and I am running on my record, don't forget, you'll know that I am a man of principle. I stand firmly with my friends." I hope y'all laughed at that. I didn't know whether you'd get it or not. I didn't know if I'd read it right or not. We stand with God one way or another. Let's pray. Father, Lord, we sure love you and praise you. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of worshiping one God, studying one Bible. And also thank you for the privilege, Father, of you having our plans, and they've already been made. God, give us purpose from the Word of God. I pray, Father, for those that do not know you as Lord and Savior. I pray, God, that you would speak to their hearts. If there's anybody sitting here today that doesn't know Jesus as their Savior, that, Father, they may give their life to you. I pray, God, that the Word of God pierces our heart and give us direction to live. I do pray, God, that during this time of invitation that we'll all listen for you, Lord, that we'll hear you. God, we'll respond if you speak to our hearts. Lord, I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll be up front if you need to make a decision for Jesus, whether you give your life to the Lord or join our church or be baptized or recommitment. You can do that in your pew or come down, and I'd love to pray with you. And if you need Jesus in your life, I'll share with you how to invite the Lord in your life. So let's stand. I'll be up front. If you need to pray, come on down.
heart's a potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence humbly I bow.
Would you close us?